Puppet. One of the alternatives to Ansible. Okay, that's enough of that. Wherever you find yourself in IT, whether you're a network engineer, system admin, cloud admin, whatever, you're gonna run into some automation tools. We just talked about Ansible, one of my favorite automation tools. We can easily automate Linux, Windows, cloud, network devices. It's amazing, I love it. But it's not the only one out there, or really even the most popular. So let's talk about Puppet. Now, some of you might be wondering, well, Chuck, why are you talking about all these automation tools? Because you need to know them. For any of the later exams we're taking, whether it be Cisco, Microsoft related, whatever, you have to know all these automation tools. You don't have to become an expert at these, don't get me wrong, but you need to know about them, what makes them different from the others, why you might choose one over the other, because guess what? Your boss might ask you that question. You might be challenged to learn one of these tools and learn them well. So I wanna make sure that you have at least just a passing understanding, just an introduction into, hey, this is what this tool does. This is how I could use it. So in this video, we're gonna talk about, hey, what is Puppet? How does it compare to Ansible and other tools like Chef? And let's get some hands-on, let's play with it. Let's actually do something with it. Puppet is definitely a huge player in the DevOps world. Now, a lot of people prefer Puppet, especially those who have been doing DevOps stuff for a long time. But when you're comparing Puppet to Ansible, they're very similar. They are both configuration management tools, but I would say that Puppet is more geared towards configuration management. Now, I don't want to start a fight in the DevOps world, but I have to say, I think Ansible is the easier option for people like me. For coming from a network engineering background where I don't do DevOps stuff, it was easier to get started, whereas Puppet is more, it's more DevOps-y. And it's very much focused on configuration management, making sure the desired state of your servers and your switches and your routers are what you want it to be, your desired state. But what does that mean exactly? Well, let me show you how Puppet works. With pretty much any automation tool you'll find out there, any DevOps situation, you'll have some kind of master node, the guy who's calling the shots. And in our case, in Puppet, it's called the Puppet Master, which I love these things. And this Puppet Master will then control his, I guess you'll call them puppets, but really they're called agents. And just like with Ansible and other automation tools, the goal is that we want to get away from individually configuring each server, having to go in, log in, and make a change, and then log in again and make a change, and keep going to your, I don't know, your hundreds of servers. We don't want to do that. Bad. Don't do that anymore. We want to use automation tools like Puppet. That's why they're there. So on Puppet, our Puppet agents will look to the Puppet Master to find out, hey, how do you want me to be? How do you want my configuration to be? What DNS server should I have? What NTP server should I have? What packages should I have installed? If you're a network engineer, what OSPF process should I be running? Puppet Master will have all that stuff on him. Specifically, he'll have it in his Puppet database or Puppet DB. Now, when we were talking about Ansible, I mentioned that there's really two models that these automation tools will use, push or pull. So with Ansible, we're gonna be pushing configuration out to our devices. Linux server, I want you to be like this. With Puppet, you'll have your servers, your routers, your switches reaching out to the Puppet Master saying, hey, how do you want me to be? Let me pull that configuration down. So it's definitely more of a pull model. You know, I'm gonna scoot this hand out of the way so we can write some cool fun facts down. I'll keep the puppets right there though. We wanna see them. Ah, gotta change up my arrows. It's the other way around. They're pulling stuff down. Now for these servers or routers or switches to actually pull down configuration and be controlled by the Puppet Master, there has to be an agent installed. So for your servers to be controlled by your Puppet Master, you'll have to attach some strings and install agents. And these agents will then periodically reach out to the Puppet Master saying, hey, am I still good? Is my configuration still good? Please let me know. And this normally happens every 1800 seconds or 30 minutes. Now, as I mentioned in my previous video, what's our problem with agent-based solutions? Well, for us network engineers, we have routers and switches that you cannot install agents on. They just don't have the capability. So we're kind of like left out in the cold with Puppet sometimes, which is why a lot of us end up using tools like Ansible, but that's really not the case anymore with Puppet. I found that Puppet is kind of a lot like Ansible. You see, they realized they need to show some love to network engineers. So they created a product called Puppet Bolt, which we'll demo here in a bit. But that's their answer to Ansible, agentless solution. And it works in a very, very similar way to Ansible. So quick recap on how that works. If you got a Linux server or, you know, a Nexus switch that actually has the ability to install an agent, well, then you'll install an agent and it'll be a typical Puppet deployment. But if you have like a Cisco iOS device or things that cannot have an agent installed, well, you can use Puppet Bolt, an agentless solution. Now, what's great about Puppet is you can install it anywhere, Windows, Mac, Linux. And it's free up to a point. I forget what the node limit is, but it is free to, you know, play with to a certain point. But once you go big, you'll want to go Puppet Enterprise, which is a paid product. Now, if you've been in IT for a bit, you know you can't just have one server. You got to have multiple servers for redundancy. You don't want to have one master going down, then you're screwed. You got to have multiple masters. And you can have that as a failover situation, or you can have multiple masters to deal with your massive deployment. And these agents would be configured to also look to this Puppet master. You could load balance, whatever. Now, Puppet is one of those things that can get crazy big for however big your deployment is. You can go for a standard monolithic deployment, which gives you up to 4,000 little puppets you can play with. Or you can go a bit bigger and go with the monolithic compile master situation, where you can go from 4,000 to 20,000 nodes and you're load balancing between multiple Puppet masters. And at that point, you're going to want to call your mom. What do you mean? There's actually something called an MOM, your mom. It stands for the Master of the Masters. And basically, you've gotten so big that you have so many Puppet Masters that you need another master to manage the masters. So it's a thing. And I thought that was so funny when I saw it that I had to mention it. You got to have a mom, because moms are the real boss. A couple more fun facts. Whereas Ansible was Python-based, Puppet is Ruby-based, another popular programming language. So if you know Ruby, well, you'll be happy with Puppet. It also has its own DSL, or domain-specific language, to interact with the Puppet master and do all your puppeteering things. Now let's talk about how they talk. This communication right here between the Puppet master and the Puppet clients or agents is TCP. This communication is nice and secure, safe, using SSL, and each of these sessions done by the agents will be using different ports, so you can have multiple agents talking to your masters all at once. All right, now let's talk about how we actually configure our servers, our routers, our switches. What does it look like? How do we actually do it? Well, let's talk about that. First, at the top of the hierarchy here, we have our manifest. It's a file we'll create, so I might call it manifest.pp. That's the extension. And this file contains code that describes configuration for our servers or our routers or switches. And this is what's pushed out when the clients and the servers want to pull something down. So they reach out and they pull it down, and the Puppet master has to, you know, give it to them. And inside that manifest file that contains all the code and programming of the state we want our stuff to be in, we will have that organized into things called classes. And what are classes keeping organized? Well, our resources. Now, the resources are similar to the tasks in Ansible. It's basically telling or stating the state you want your server to be in. So, for example, I want my Linux server to have Apache installed. That would be one resource. It's a declared state. Apache installed, one of our resources. Or in the case of a network engineer, it might be that, hey, I want loopback interface 7 on all my switches. That would be another resource declaring that state. And going back up the chain, these resources, these tasks, the way we want our server to be, are organized into classes, and these classes and resources are all contained in our manifest file, which is all that code that we deploy to our servers. And then going even bigger, this whole thing right here, this whole thing can also be organized into a module. A module could contain a bunch of these different manifests. This is a common way we would organize our code, our Puppet code. And that's Puppet in a nutshell. It's very similar to Ansible or our other automation tool we talked about. They both help us manage our possibly large infrastructures from one central location, keeping our configuration tight and managed. And Puppet's very focused on the configuration management part. Whereas Ansible can do configuration management, it can do deployment and such, Puppet really wants to hone in on the configuration management piece. So as you consider where you might land on what automation tool to use, keep that in mind. And that's why Puppet is very popular for our DevOps people. It's agent-based. Most of the time, you're going to install an agent on the things you're going to control. So you have your Puppet master, the guy who's controlling and controlling all the puppets, the puppeteer. What do you call those guys? Marionettes. And you'll install your Puppet agents on the servers you want to control. In the networking world, you can do that on a Nexus switch that has the ability. But you can go agentless mode with Puppet Bolt, which allows us to manage the other devices in our network. Now, Puppet's not as pushy as Ansible. It's more of a pull model. So the agents on these servers will reach out to the Puppet master saying, hey, how do I look? And if they're out of whack, if the configuration got jacked up, or if there's something new they need to add, they'll pull down that configuration, which that configuration will be in the form of a manifest file, which describes their state. The manifest file will have all these resources or descriptions of like, hey, you need Apache installed, or hey, you need this NTP server. And the config is applied, and they'll check in every 1800 seconds or 30 minutes. Okay, let's get our hands dirty with Puppet. This lab will be very specific to network engineers. We'll be using Puppet Bolt to mess with a router. Now, this won't be a deep dive into how to make Puppet your master controller for everything. No, this will be a simple exercise to just demonstrate, hey, I can use Puppet to do this one thing. And then I want that idea to grow into, well, I can do this, everything. Anyways, now there's some great documentation out there to get Puppet Bolt installed and get started with Cisco IOS. But I went ahead and did all that work for you. I have it all set up and ready in a Docker container. What is that? Well, go back and watch my Docker video. If you already know, then here's the image right here. The NetworkChuck Puppet. I'm gonna go ahead and deploy mine right now. I'll go to a node and deploy a Docker container real quick. You can also lab this up on my course at CBT Nuggets. Check out the link below. It's in the CCNP Encore course that we just released. Yeah, so you should go check it out. 7-day free trial, go. Anyways, I'm going to deploy my Docker container right now. I've already got a Docker VM running out there in the wild. I'll connect to that through SolarPuddy, my favorite SSH program. I know I keep mentioning that, but it's my favorite and it's free. You should go download that as well. I'm gonna run the sucker, Docker container run -dt. I'll name this Puppet Bolt, and the image is the NetworkChuck /Puppet. Done. If it's your first time running this, it will go through and download that image. And then I'm going to jump into that container by doing docker exec -it, the name of my container, Puppet Bolt, and then I'll connect to bash, and I'm in. If I do an ls to list the files here in my directory, you'll see that I have one called Puppet Stuff right there. We'll want to change directories into that real quick. So we'll do cd Puppet Stuff, and there we'll have all our Puppet Stuff. Now, just like Ansible, we have an inventory file that contains all the nodes or hosts we're controlling. And this is Puppet Bolt specific, because these devices we're controlling don't have agents installed like you typically would with a typical Puppet installation. So I'm gonna jump into that file real quick, vi-inventory.yaml, it's a YAML file. I didn't spell it right. Inventory, there we go. I have two targets or nodes that we're gonna be controlling. One is actually in my lab, Cisco IOS 2. You can ignore that or add your own targets in there. But the first one is actually a freely available Cisco IOS device thanks to DevNet, developer.cisco.com. Now, at the time of this recording, this thing is open, ready to go, and amazing. It is possible that it may be different, or it may be gone, or the password or username has changed, or whatever. To verify or check on that, you can go to developer.cisco.com. Let me show you real quick. If you don't already have an account, set up that account. And we can navigate over to Discover and Sandbox Remote Labs. This is where you can actually play with Cisco stuff for free. It's amazing. This is a great example. They have planned maintenance coming up. So if there's an issue, go check out the site. And to make sure your box is still available, we can go to, let's say, networking, for example. I normally go to the very bottom and click on, under all networking sandboxes, I'll click on here to look at the entire library they have. And then I'll filter that by changing the type from whatever it is to always on. Always on means you don't have to reserve it. It's always there for you to play with and test. And I can see right here, there's a couple that we have right here, iOS, XE, on CSR. We have two boxes we could play with. They're always on, and they have the credentials once you jump in there. And then here's one on iOS XR. We have Nexus, so just keep that in mind. If you ever run into an issue, go out to the site and see if they have another option for you. So if this info is still golden for you, or if you want to add your own stuff, you can just kind of copy the format here. It's a YAML file, so be sure and give it its space, some breathing room. Otherwise, I'm good to go. Now, the first thing I want to do is what we kind of do with Ansible. We can run ad hoc commands to our Cisco devices just like we would normally when we're logging in. So let's do that real quick. The command will be bolt, because we're using Puppet Bolt, task run. We'll specify that we're using the Cisco IOS task module. And then I'll put :: and specify that we're using CLI_command. Then I'll point it at what I want to mess with. So in my inventory file, I had two nodes I could look at. Actually, I forgot what they were called. Let me go back in there real quick. VI inventory. So the alias was Cisco IOS and then Cisco IOS 2. You can name those whatever you want. I just named it that. So I'll mess with the Cisco IOS, which will be this IOS XE box out there on the DevNet site that you can access right now as well. So my target will be Cisco_IOS. And then getting some Ansible flashbacks, it'll be command equals. And then between these single quotes, we'll put our command. So I'll do maybe show run. So get a show running there. Then after that, I'll put a raw equals true with that raw data. And let's try it out. This is cool because it's actually reaching out to this DevNet box. Now, there's some Ruby errors that come up. Don't worry about that. It's going to slide right through that and give you some nice stuff right here at the bottom. And there it all is. Just like that, I got a show run using Puppet, ad hoc commands. Easy enough. And any command you want to use, you can apply that, just like we do with Ansible. Now let's utilize a manifest file. So if I list my files in that container or that directory once more, I've got two manifest files I want to play with. We've got our lookup.pp and our motd.pp. PP indicating the Puppet manifest file. Let's jump in and edit the first one we're going to mess with, motd. So I'll do vimotd.pp to edit this guy. And here you can kind of already tell what I'm doing, right? I'm changing the banner, and it's the message of the day banner. And we're going to change that to hello friends. And actually, that's kind of lame. I'm going to change that. I'm going to hit I to go into insert mode, and I'm going to change hello friends to network Chuck was here. I'll hit escape, colon, WQ to write and quit. And now it's ready to go. We're going to apply that configuration, declare that state to that router. The command will be bolt apply. We'll specify our manifest file, which was motd.pp. And we'll do dash T to specify our target. And the target will be Cisco underscore iOS. That was the alias we assigned to that. And that's it. Let's do it. Give me all that error. Once more, just ignore that. I couldn't figure out how to make that go away. But the bottom here, I think it has something to do with the container. But the bottom here is what we're looking at. So it's applying the configuration now to our Cisco iOS device. And boom. Similar to Ansible, we get a kind of a play-by-play, like, hey, something changed. One thing changed. No failures, nothing unchanged, nothing skipped. And what's cool is that we even get a notice here. Notice we changed from hello friends to network Chuck was here. Let's go verify that. I want to log into that router. Do a show run. I'll begin with motd. There it is. NetworkChuck was here. Let's verify that on the command line of Puppet, right? We can do that. So I'll use my same command earlier, my bolt task run with the CLI, and I'll change the show run to show run begin motd. We'll get the same info just from Puppet. And same info right there. Now, Puppet is a complex tool. What we just did is very, very, very basic. And my goal with this wasn't to make you an expert overnight, because it won't happen. I just wanted you to see Puppet. Say you've used it at least once and know how it compares as an automation tool to other automation tools. Well, guys, that's about it. I wanted to cover Puppet because we covered Ansible and they're similar. Let me know if you want me to cover other tools as well. And if you want to see those tools covered right now, go check out my course on CBT Nuggets, CCNP Encore. I did this course with Keith Barker, Jeremy Chara, Jeff Kish, Knox Hutchinson, Jacob Moran, just a bunch of people. And it's amazing. So if you're looking at getting your CCNP, link below. Well, guys, that's about it. I'll catch y'all later.